Lenny Kravitz is here in 15 minutes on BBC Choice Now with Grace and the voice of an angel. I'll go to myself one day. Jeff Buckley's Rock Shrine.
My life will never be the same. Never, never be the same. And I miss him every moment.
I just sort of started writing on my own, and they said, you have to come and hear this guy sing because it's going to really totally blow your mind. And I went and I started at the back of the room, and by the end of the gig I was like right at the front of the stage, just like...
Jeff Buckley first burst onto the music scene in 1995 with his debut album Grace. It became one of the albums of the 90s, and Jeff seemed destined for greatness.
And you know, I mean, he just had the kind of voice that just made a room go quiet. It was stunning, to say the least. The guy was amazing.
Kiss me.
I'd never heard a voice like that. Incredibly powerful and beautiful, and conveys emotion in a way I don't think many people do.
It was almost as if there was this idea that music could mean something again.
He died aged 30. After accidentally drowning while swimming in the Mississippi River.
Jeff Buckley's death was a huge loss to music. It's just very frustrating sometimes when you think about things like that. It just doesn't seem fair or right.
On the anniversary of his death, fans pay their respects to Jeff next to a small shrine located in Memphis Zoo. Jeff lived next door to the zoo and used to visit regularly before he died.
Of all the places I think you can go to remember Jeff, this would be it. They said his favorite were the tigers and the butterflies. He wouldn't leave without seeing the butterflies.
Well, I heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you?
This is the butterfly exhibit in the zoo here. And basically, he applied for a job here and was going to work here. He was not a rock star. It's not like he lived extravagantly by any means. It was just simply a cup of tea and a pen and paper for the most part. So he would make the effort to get out, and he would like, you know, come to the zoo.
Well, there was a time when you let me know what's really going on below, but now you never show that to me. But remember when I moved in you, and the holy dove was moving too, and every breath we drew is hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah. This is one of the tapes, and I made them this morning. It says, "Who is Jeff Buckley? Please take one." I thought this would be the best way that I could make some kind of offering for him. Since he's not here and he can't spread his music, at least I can. He left some music behind, and we're just trying to remember him today. So you can take one if you'd like.
It's a song about a dream.
Jeff had moved to Memphis in order to write new songs and prepare for his second album.
I saw that he was going to be performing in Memphis. And I was like, there's no way. It says every Monday. That's impossible. Jeff Buckley in Memphis every Monday. So I started going to the shows at Barrister's. It was just him and a guitar and a small amp on stage. I mean, I was 6 feet away from him. And it was like the most amazing musical experience of my life.
The blanket is warm. This body will never be safe from home. Still feel your hair, black ribbons of coal. Touch my skin, keep me home.
It was incredible. He had, Ken had his hands over my eyes so that I would not see Jeff, but I heard him. The moment that he escorted me to the door and I started to cry, and I could not believe it. I was shaking. I could not believe that Jeff Buckley was actually in town and at Barrister's, of all places. I'd never been to that club before. I just knew it was kind of an underground bar in the middle of an alley. When Jeff played, no one spoke, but it was a very quiet, intimate setting. People gave a lot of respect when he played.
It's almost like church. Everybody paid attention and was very focused on what he was doing. He was a pretty mesmerizing player live. My look on his face, you could tell he was so into it and so happy to be doing what he was doing.
We had the privilege to speak with him for, I guess, 10 or 15 minutes at the bar one night after he was finished, and seemed like he was in love with life.
What did he talk about?
Well, he really liked you. I think that he was trying to pick up on my girlfriend. I think.
He was there to give you everything he had that night if it killed him. And he would do that if there were two people in the room. And indeed, in the beginning, there were times when he would show up, you know, at a coffee house in Buffalo, and there'd only be eight people. And he'd give them the same performance he would to a Coliseum full of people.
The bass and the energy just kept going, and he just wanted to give it all he could go. He just wanted to almost till he just emotionally passed out. It was such an intense experience. I don't think he really knew what he was going to do next. I think he just, you know, he may have known the first few songs, but those last ones, I think he was just trying to get out whatever he could get out.
He was so grateful and so appreciative of the way the audience responded to him. It was a visceral thing for him. He actually, you know, felt it like a hot heat coming up from them. The more passionate they were, the more passionate he was.
If you think about Jeff and some of these other people, it's like how fast and furious everything was surrounding them. How much anticipation there was for each and every movement, every chord, every note. A short, really hot, burning fuse. And that's maybe where Jeff was. So this is the house that Jeff ended up renting and living in. Looks the same as when he was here, except the grass was about this tall when Jeff was here. But it's basically one story and has an attic, and Jeff would work in that room right there. It was his four-track room, and had a crushed green velvet velour couch that my wife and I let him have to sleep on, and a mattress. And, to sleep on, leaving to sleep on the couch. Oh, somebody's home. Hi.
A devoted fan now lives in the house, but was reluctant to talk.
I'd love to just ask you what it's like living in his house, but...
Yeah, but it's incredibly personal.
Is it?
I mean, of course it is. Of course it is. This house is my healing process. It's nobody else's business, rumors go wild. I'm just not interested. That's not the effect that any time we spend together, it will be seen in music that I do if that becomes successful, and then that's all that needs to be heard.
His looks, I think, was something that probably initially get fans. They see a poster, they see the cover of the CD, and they think, wow, you know, he's pretty cute. I'd like to check him out. But then once they hear the music and find out more about who Jeff was, they realize that it's more about the music and not necessarily his looks.
He didn't want to be one of people's 50 most beautiful people. That's not how Jeff wanted to be remembered. He wanted to make absolutely glorious music.
This room is awesome.
When I was in school, I really didn't know what I wanted to do with my life, and I felt kind of lost. And I was listening to Jeff, and the music just let me have a vent for the emotion that I felt.
Anytime that I, you know, felt down or sad, I would go home and put it on. And I used to go to sleep at night listening to it a lot of times.
People would come up and go, you know, I started painting again, or I started writing poetry again after I heard Grace. And see, that's amazing. Utterly amazing. Yeah, Jeff was quite a human being.
Last time I saw Jeff, I had to explain to him that I just got a new job. I wouldn't be able to stay up till 5 in the morning and watch him sing every week, all that sort of thing. So I wouldn't be seeing him for a while, but I'd catch him when he went on tour, and gave me a hug when I left. And that was it's a good way to remember him.
As the sun sets, a group of fans make it down to the Mississippi River, at the very spot where Jeff disappeared.
Lilac wine is sweet and heady. Where's my love?
You know, it's just weird. It's still really weird. You know, because I really miss him. He was a good friend.
I feel unsteady.
We used to spend a lot of time over here. Jeff and my wife, some friends. This is, Jeff was very fond of the porch.
Listen to me, boys.
Hey, Jeff, I took some naps on the swing.
Or am I just going crazy?
We enjoyed drinking wine together, yeah. Red wine was the intoxicant of choice. He always come by with a bottle of Forest Glen.
Lilac wine, I feel I'm ready for.